on behalf of Chris and all of the family members, I want to thank you for taking the time this evening to come together. This evening, we congregate as a community to mourn the passing of Ashley Picco, an incredible woman, wife, daughter, granddaughter, niece, co-worker, friend, and as my brother Chris said, a perfect mother. We are also here to mourn the loss of a precious Lennon Picco, who many of us are so anxiously waiting to meet, spend time with, and watch grow. However, we're not just here to mourn. We're also here to lift up and support Chris and Ashley's family through this very difficult time. We as a community gather this evening to show our love and support, not for just now, but for the difficult days to come. Finally, we're here to join in celebration. We congregate this evening to celebrate the 30 years we were blessed to spend with Ashley, to celebrate the 4 days we were privileged to have with Lennon. Perhaps most importantly, we gather to celebrate the hope that we will see them both soon. So tonight, as we gather to mourn, to support, and to say goodbye for now, we do so knowing that the dawn is coming. The dawn is coming when we will once again gather. We will gather in celebration, but not for Ashley and Lennon, but with Ashley and Lennon. So thank you for joining us this evening. I am sure both Ashley and Lennon would be so honored that you've taken the time to be here.
Would you pray with me? Gracious God, it is difficult to believe that it's been a week. In many ways, it seems like the last week has been a lifetime. A week of leaning on each other, of weeping sorrowful tears, of trying to remember passages of hope, and of grieving Ashley and Lennon. We come here this evening, Lord, drawn together by a common woundedness, a common sorrow, but also drawn inexorably to this place by a common hope. A hope in the one who knew what it was to weep, who knew what it was to die, and who knows what it is to rise again. We come here drawn certainly by Ashley and Lennon, but also drawn here by the one who holds the keys of death and the grave, and who says, "I am the resurrection and the life." Lord, let us be honest enough that we can speak our questions and express our sorrow. But let us be faithful enough that we can turn our eyes to you and cling to the hope you extend. Bless each person this evening, Lord, who sings, who speaks, who prays. Bless each one who weeps. And Lord, as a community, we gather around Ashley's family, around Chris's family, and just pray that through our hands, your touch might be felt. So grace us with your presence is my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved, and how precious did that grace appear. The hour I first believed, the Lord has promised.
Ashley's story, I think, is a love story. And like all love stories,
I'm sorry.
Okay. Thank you, sir. There we go. Like all love stories, it ends too soon. And yet it hasn't really ended, has it? Like most love stories, it's a sweet story. But like most love stories, it's also a bittersweet story. And like most love stories, it touches the hearts of all who have witnessed it at close range. And it seems that through the media, electronic and social, it has touched and touches hundreds, thousands, even millions of lives around the world, both women and men. Ashley won my heart when she was a very, very little girl. It seemed to me that she and I had some special kind of chemistry, a singular bond, a unique friendship. And she would sit on my lap and we would talk and snuggle, and I congratulated myself with the thought that I was her favorite uncle, that I had some special charm, some special way with kids that attracted her. But I've learned the truth about Ashley. She was the one with the magic. She was the one with the charm. And she could always, even then, make anyone feel special. And you know, she didn't lose that as she grew up. An informal and totally unscientific survey of family, friends, and Facebook entries makes it clear that Ashley had great, great personal people skills. She was warm and she was welcoming. She was always ready with a hug. In fact, there were members of her family who dubbed her a serial hugger. You didn't have to be around her very long to discern that she was a very positive person. That positive spirit was infectious. It was very natural and graceful, the way that Ashley could make you feel good, even about yourself. Close family members say that she was diplomatic. She tried to bring people together and never had a disparaging word for anyone. She was never the cause or the center of contention. And when she encountered it, she did her best to dispel it. She was happy and always respectful, and yet sometimes a little bit sassy. Several of her close family members condensed their memories to a few lines, including these. Ashley was creative in consideration of others. She loved to cook, plan parties and small events like baby showers, church gatherings, and get-togethers. She loved things like scarves and toe socks, and basically anything that was quirky and cute like herself. And she had an unwavering faith in her church. She was always up for a rousing family game night and a quick nosh. Never a disparaging word, not even a curse, escaped her lips, they say. She loved blue, dogs, going to the beach. One of her nursing student friends wrote this just a few hours ago. I think this is really revealing about Ashley. She was not a pushover. She was not passive in life. We went to nursing school together, and one day at lunch, someone in our group made a comment about a style of dress that a classmate had chosen. Ashley politely told us we needed to stop being catty and that we should all be accepting of how people wanted to express themselves through clothes. It shut us all up. This is the day, I believe, I went from liking Ashley to loving her. Back in the spring of 2002, Ashley went to New York City with a youth group from Northern California. They were going to help with the cleanup efforts there in New York City several months after the terrible disaster there at the World Trade Center. And it was a sobering, life-shaking experience for any of us who were there. For Ashley, there was a little added something in that experience. There were other Adventist young people that were there at the same time, from other parts of the country and some even from a foreign country. That is when Chris Picco met than Ashley Elizabeth Wood. He did not know it at the time, but he might as well have signed the surrender papers right then and there. Although several years passed before their relationship matured and they married, the die was cast right there. But, you know, Ashley would boast to her friends that she had snagged a handsome musician. And she always made it sound like she was the lucky one. Chris knows better. In the summer of 2003, Ashley left California for another adventure. She went to work at a youth camp back in northeastern Kansas, Broken Arrow Ranch. Along with her luggage, she took her guitar, protected only by a cloth, soft carrying case. And some careless airline employee mishandled it, and Ashley ended up with a cracked instrument. Somehow, it survived the entire summer. Unusable, but nobody threw it on a bonfire, and nobody used it for kindling at a campout. So at the end of the summer, Ashley felt it would be useless to return to California carrying the broken guitar. But fun-loving individual that Ashley always was, she was creative about that broken guitar. And she and several of her friends devised an adaptation to an ancient Viking ritual. The lakeside ceremony included dousing the guitar inside and out with lighter fluid, setting it afire, and watching it with restrained reverence as it drifted out over the waters of Tuttle Creek Reservoir. She found a way to turn the broken guitar into a happy, fun event, typical of Ashley. Now, Ashley came from a long line of gourmet caliber cooks. Friends even now rave about her specialties, from world-class salads to s'mores baked in canning jars. And when the season was right, she would make minestrone soup from an old Italian family recipe. But on the other hand, she loved nacho cheese. And I'm not talking about something you'd whip up from an ancient Mexican family restaurant, a recipe book. I'm talking about the stuff, that ugly, gooey, melty yellow stuff you buy in a can off the grocer's shelf. She wants the real thing. Now, we should not suppose that Ashley's prowess in the kitchen didn't have any downsides. One of the most embarrassing days of her life was when she was a freshman at Pacific Union College. Her Aunt Jan was the dean of women, and one day when she was away, she asked Ashley to house-sit her apartment. And it seems that Ashley had what you'd call an accident in the kitchen. A little something burned in the oven. It was well contained, but the oven emitted copious black clouds of smoke that set off the fire alarms throughout the dormitory. And to her chagrin, the signal reached the fire department. And they came roaring up in their fire trucks, localizing the source of the smoke. And on their way, they attracted the attention of the president of the college, who, like many, decided to follow the fire trucks. And the firemen and the president of the college arrived at the door of the apartment to find Ashley, helpless and unable to do anything about this predicament over which she had absolutely no control. And later, when she reported the incident to her aunt, she was consoled with the words, "Well, at least you got a chance to meet the president." In addition to being a great cook, Ashley had a green thumb like you wouldn't believe. Also inherited, I'm sure, from her maternal grandmother. Now, Ashley lived in an upstairs apartment, and there's not much room for a garden in an upstairs apartment. But when Ashley looked out her window, she noticed that her apartment was adjacent to the roof of a garage. The only ingress and egress was through the window. But Ashley made her own Garden of Eden on the roof of that garage, hauling the containers and the soil up the stairs, in and out the window to water. She grew vegetables and herbs, which of course ended up in one or another of her gourmet meals. Fellow nursing students say that Ashley was the perfect mix of class and sass. And in their group, she was famous for her cooking and for having in her kitchen almost every possible attachment to any worthwhile KitchenAid mixer. They would always beg her to host their study groups because they knew it always meant homemade pasta and soup. And they say that she's the only person they ever knew of who wanted a vacuum cleaner and compost on her birthday. Ashley made the most of holidays. You know, she was delighted when she married Chris and found out that the Canadian Thanksgiving doesn't fall on the same day as the American Thanksgiving. And even as she grew up, she kept up a childhood tradition. She thought that Easter was the best holiday of all, and she always had to have an Easter basket. And that Easter basket always had to include, if you mind the expression, peeps. You know what peeps are? And there was one particular Easter while Ashley was in New York City. And she happened to be staying with my wife and I in our apartment there. And her mother warned us that Easter was coming and that it was our duty to provide an adequate Easter basket for Ashley. And my wife did that, including the peeps. And we had to go out to an appointment that particular afternoon or evening. And Ashley consoled herself in her loneliness in that apartment by consuming the contents of her Easter basket. But I am told that she has continued that tradition of the Easter basket. Now, Ashley had a thing for babies and little kids. And she loved them, and they responded so well to her. And that's what made her such a good nurse. She had a way of putting them at ease and calming them down, even in the most stressful situations. One mother told of how Ashley took care of her little kids, and the first time she ever drew blood from a small child was with this lady's little boy. And Ashley, she could tell, was very, very nervous about finding the vein in this little child's arm. She said that she made it on the second try. And a look of relief came over Ashley's face because she was so fearful of hurting the child. That was Ashley's sensitivity. Ashley was thrilled when her sister-in-law, Chantel, gave birth to her first little nephew. And she said, "Now I'm an auntie." But you know what she really wanted to be? She really wanted to be a mommy. And she announced her pregnancy with a wonderful sense of humor that delighted all of her friends and family. You know, this was to be like the hallmark experience of Ashley's life, where all of her gifts, her natural gifts and her talents and her skills would come together. There is absolutely no question what kind of a mother Ashley would have been. Ashley's journey toward her chosen profession was hampered by circumstances. It was hindered by disappointments, and it was deterred by setbacks. Family members wondered if she was really cut out to be a nurse. After all, she'd be such a great teacher. But this did not dampen Ashley's determination. She pushed on with nursing, one step, one level, one victory at a time. That she did not live long enough to achieve her ultimate professional goal does not matter. What matters is that she kept on and on and on. And that speaks volumes about her character. Ashley's story is about a girl who learned that love and commitment can be risky ventures. The closest bonds can fail. Hearts can be broken. Hopes can be disappointed. Now, that could turn some people cynical, untrusting, and pessimistic about life. Yet, it didn't happen to Ashley. She dared to love. She dared to commit. She dared to do life as a full immersion experience. She's a model for the rest of us. Some of us here are already old, and you young ones, it's going to happen to you too. But Ashley will never grow old. She'll stay young in our hearts, alive and vibrant in our memories. And what we have now is the hope of a joyful reunion and life forever together in a world where we will never grow old.
In the wee hours of Saturday, November 8, 2014, Lennon James Picco was born. His unexpected entrance brought the hope of life into the midst of tragedy. His premature arrival, combined with the loss of his mother, Ashley, united the medical community, family, and friends into immediate action by surrounding him with the best medical care possible. A shroud of prayer that covered his little incubator and ascended to heaven, and love was lavished upon his beautiful little body. As the hours of his precious life ticked by, the story of his struggle to live spread like lightning across the globe, and thousands of people began to pray for his survival. Strangers in airplanes, hallways, and offices shed tears as the story of little Lennon was told and retold. His little body fought bravely against the odds. Around the clock, doctors, nurses, family, and friends gathered around his little bed to provide medical care, to look at his little face, to hold his delicate, tiny hands, to shower him with words of love and encouragement, and will him to live. Fragile, delicate, tiny Lennon was cherished by all who saw him. His visit with us may have been brief, but the impact of his life will bring tears today and hope for a better tomorrow. In the final hours of Lennon's life, his daddy, Chris, brought his guitar into the NIC unit and began to sing to little Lennon. Together they shared a sacred moment, music drowning out the whir of the machines. Footage of this intimate moment between father and son was shared on YouTube and has been viewed by countless millions. Because of the updates Chris posted on Facebook, numerous conversations, news outlets, and websites have shared the story of Lennon's struggle for life and his father Chris's faith and hope and belief that a better day is coming when Jesus returns. On Tuesday evening, November 11, surrounded by doctors, nurses, family, and friends, Lennon James Picco slipped quietly away, snuggled in the arms of his daddy. As we mourn his passing, we wait impatiently for the day when we will be reunited with Lennon, and he will be placed in the arms of his mommy and daddy, never to be separated again.
My name is Marie, and this is Justine, and we've known Ashley for the better half of our lifetimes. She was our best friend, and today is a day that we could never imagine having to live through. The outpouring of love and support has been truly moving. Ashley, Lennon, and Chris have touched so many people, friends and strangers alike. We reached out to Ashley's friends and family over the past few days, asking for a word to describe her, and what we got in response was breathtaking. These are the things that Ashley embodied and emulated every single day to everyone around her. She was feisty, inviting.
Loving and silly.
She was thoughtful, caring, and inspiring.
She was a nerd, our monkey girl.
Ashley was gracious, beautiful, warm, and nurturing.
Giggly, honest, authentic, and adventurous.
She was spunky, witty, mischievous, and sassy.
An irreplaceable treasure and a timeless melody.
She was charming, hilarious, playful, and sincere. Ashley was the type of person who could and would brighten anyone's day, sweeten anyone's sour mood, or make anyone's cup magically become half full with nothing more than a smile. It's because she smiled with her whole body and with her whole heart. She smiled with patience, with understanding, with compassion, but most importantly, she smiled with intention. You would immediately feel enveloped by her warmth, her comfort, and her support. Ashley lived for laughter and friendship, for family, and for love. We feel so lost without her, as we know most of you do as well. So we ask you to do what she would have done in this moment and look to the person next to you and smile. Let her light shine through you. Let you be her guiding light to brighten the lives of others, and let her live on in all of us. Thank you.
Hi. My name's Michelle, and Ashley was one of my best friends. Ashley was in my life for as long as I can remember. I was in kindergarten at Napa Adventist Junior Academy when she was in second grade. But I don't really remember her from that time. We didn't know each other. It wasn't until I was in middle school and she was in high school that we took Taekwondo together by chance. And we were sparring one day, and I got frustrated because Ashley was better than me, and I slapped her in the face. And I don't think that's strictly in the rule books of Taekwondo. But Ashley being Ashley was gracious and laughed it off and forgave me and invited me to youth group with her. She thought I needed Jesus. So I went to youth group with Ashley, and we had so much fun together. We were just ridiculous, and we were off the walls, and we made our youth pastor go crazy trying to chase us around. We sneaked out of conferences and hiked around the hills of Leone Meadows when we probably shouldn't have. Ashley and I had so many memories together that I can't even possibly begin to capture, one of them being going to New York and meeting Chris and having the same antics in New York. Later, we moved to Seattle together so that she could be close to Chris, and I just wanted to get out of town. So we had great adventures in Pike Place Market and drinking hot chocolate on snow days and making fires in our tiny apartment. Ashley was always so warm and so fun to be around. And then I just wanted to say a few things about just Ashley's amazingness and everything that was Ashley and the things that are gonna stick with me about her. And I think the biggest thing that all of us keep saying is just that she was so joyful. And everything that she did was just this contagious, incredible bundle of joy and fun. And she brought fun into every situation. She was a great listener. She would remember things that I had said years later, even though I had forgotten the details of my own life. She helped me figure out how to be a person. I, as a kid, was this tomboy with braces and, like, basically no eyebrows because someone tried to help me and it went wrong. And Ashley helped me learn how to put on makeup when I was in college, and helped me figure out what clothes to wear and how to put myself together. I was lost without her. She always celebrated. She always brought more joy. She always brought more happiness. She always was spontaneous. She was up for anything. And I know that one thing that she would want to remember about her was that she would have been a great, great mama. I mean, all of us know that about her too. So Ashley, you played a huge part in making me who I am. I'll miss you forever.
My name is Casey, and this is my wife, Natalie, and we're the Hohenseys, and we had the incredible gift of sharing life with Chris and Ashley for the last 7 years. Honey, you need to make smart choices, Ashley said, as their adventure heading to the airport after a visit with friends was currently on hold in the middle of Brooklyn at 3 a.m. Chris and Ashley's trip to New York City had been so fun, but right now, in the middle of the night, with the subway stopped due to an obstruction on the tracks, and left stranded with luggage in a very sketchy part of town, they were unable to hail a cab. Although Chris had spent a significant time in Brooklyn a few years earlier and felt no imminent danger, Ashley's instructions were clear: make smart choices. Over the last 7 years, many of us here at the Loma Linda community have been witness to smart choices made over and over again by our precious friend Ashley.
In compiling stories and thoughts, the overwhelming thread that has woven through all of them is this: Ashley's focus in life was always to make others feel special and appreciated. This gift was manifested in sharing countless meals, being a founder of the Lonely Hearts Club, and her unwavering support of Chris's music and ministry. Always it was about others, rarely about her.
Ashley and Chris's journey with many of us began at the newly established Young Adult Sabbath School, Relive. Chris was instantly embraced as a worship leader, and Ashley, his best friend and most fervent supporter, was always at his side. Many of us can recall game nights of Settlers of Catan or Farkle, where suddenly this mild-mannered, often quiet woman would get fiercely competitive, yet still kind and generous in her reactions. When someone would take too long to play their turn, she would say, "Go ahead now." A phrase still used by friends today. Smart choices.
These game night interactions started becoming more than that and started including food. And if you were to ask any one of us friends what was one of Ashley's favorite things to do, it would be cook. And rarely was it ever because it was necessary. More so, it was because she found joy in the artistry of cooking. And I think each of us friends that benefited from her cooking will thank Grandma Daryl, Elizabeth, and all the aunties for passing down some of our favorite recipes that she would make. The countless soups, salads, and more are highlights to many of us. And yet, when we'd ask, thinking it was a long, drawn-out, time-consuming recipe, she'd simply say, "Oh, no. It's so simple," and it always was. Smart choices.
Ashley's love for cooking and baking was regularly discussed in the same voice with her love of the restaurants, especially in Napa. Rutherford Grill's veggie plate, Modell Bakery's English muffin, and so much more were always a part of this discussion. A few lucky friends actually were able to join her on her excursions back home and experience these treats firsthand. Then, of course, there was her love for her family holiday dinners. Thanksgiving, in particular, was a fun discussion where she'd share with who was allowed to cook and when, and how excited she was when Grandma Daryl would compliment her cooking.
Thanksgiving was also a big deal for some of us down here, except it was Canadian Thanksgiving that was celebrated. Many friends shared memories from the mid-October event that was always looked forward to. This year's gathering especially was full of fond memories, being in the new Picco house, decorated beautifully and filled with the toys and items awaiting Lennon's arrival. That, and it was clearly a good reason to have a Thanksgiving meal twice a year, nearly back to back. Smart choices.
For the majority of their time here, the Piccos were residents at the aptly named Lamar Mansion, a set of four apartments in one building. And the different couples and families that moved in and out constantly stayed close. Many recall times when they would get a waft of her cooking before seeing her and would jokingly make a comment about how they were looking forward to dinner, always with Ashley's response being, "Well, come eat then." Always the generous hostess, always the kind friend. Sabbaths were a special time for so many of us. Many of us friends would be so incredibly busy during the week that Sabbath morning spent at Relive would often culminate with a lunch shared by a big group of us, more often than not, at Delhi Palace, a local Indian restaurant. Due to our group size, we were often put in separate sections of the restaurant and would spend hours, even after finishing eating, just talking and being in fellowship. For some of us, those afternoons would then turn into visits at the parks with our dogs, relaxing afternoon talks in a living room, and eventually popcorn and movies after dark. No matter where you come from or what background you have with the Sabbath, these afternoons were what a day of rest should be filled with: worship and fellowship with friends. More smart choices.
One of Ashley's greatest gifts was her love for and ability to interact with children. Although Ashley was likely ready for kids a long time before Chris, it was clear she was meant to be a mother, and many of us around her were very aware of her preparedness for that big event. And then the big day, the big reveal in late August, began a fun journey for all of us friends and family, buying, passing down items in the excitement of preparing for Lennon. Every item Ashley purchased was perfect. His room would be vintage robots and toys. There was no denying her incredible flair for design and aesthetic. But more than that, Ashley was so gifted with providing advice and beautiful direction for us new parents. Many of us mothers in our group believe that we are better moms simply by being around Ashley. Lennon didn't have a great mom. He had the best mom. Smart choices.
So what would Ashley tell us if she could share one last piece of advice with us. We believe it would go something like this. Hey, guys. Love intensely. Love deeply. And love bravely. We were put here for each other, so let's act like it. Cherish every meal, enjoy every bite, and always, always cook for your guests. Live life to the fullest, no matter how much you have, and be generous in every circumstance. Find the best in everyone and every situation, even the dark times. Most importantly, please, honey, you need to make smart choices.
I'm Cameo Carter-Walls, and we were blessed enough to have Ashley work at our pediatric practice as our nurse. I first met Ashley years ago when my youngest son started preschool at the Loma Linda Children's Center. Ashley was his teacher, and we immediately fell in love with her. I know I can echo the sentiment of many parents out there who had Ashley as their babysitter or nanny or as their preschool teacher. And when you were handing off your kid to Ashley, you didn't worry. At that drop-off at the beginning of the day, she would scoop them up into her arms and they were excited to see her. And then when we came at the end of the day to pick up our child, we would often have a funny story or something adorable that she recounted to us. Our kids were loved, they were cared for, they were joyously taught, and they were known by her. Even years later, Ashley could recount specific stories of her little students, bringing us parents back to those cherished early years. Knowing Ashley's heart of service, it was no surprise that she not only went to nursing school, but flourished in it. She told me on a number of occasions how much she loved to learn, how much she enjoyed school. I was so lucky that we kept in touch during this time, because when she completed her degree, and completed it well, she asked if I knew of any nursing job openings. We didn't have any nursing job openings at our practice. In fact, up until that point, we had only hired medical assistants. But knowing Ashley, adoring Ashley, I suddenly knew that I had to have a nurse at our practice because I had to have Ashley at my practice. And we never once regretted our decision. This was a new role and a new model that we were developing by bringing her on board. But she was up for the challenge and was integral in developing that role. She did so much professionally and personally for our practice. In fact, one of the last exchanges I had with her a week ago, as I hurried out the door on a Friday afternoon, she reminded me, I think for the third time, about something I'd forgotten. And I said, Ashley, thank you. You're always taking care of me. What would I do without you? I just never thought I would have to answer that question. She was so dedicated to our mission. We had so many more things we wanted to accomplish together. We had plans of how we were going to do more, teach more, and expand her role even further. But it wasn't like Ashley needed more work to do. We gave her plenty. She was always so humble, so you might not know all that she did for our pediatric clinic. She first started her day out by following up on the patients who had utilized our on-call night service, finding out how our sweet sick patient was doing, how the parents were doing, and how she could help them further, whether by giving more advice or by seeing if she needed to bring them in for an appointment with us. She triaged phone calls and talked through recommendations to our worried parents throughout the day, while at the same time assisting the doctors with procedures, fighting for our patients with insurance companies to get the medications they needed, spending extra time with parents just to make sure that they understood their child's treatment plan, assessing the sicker kids and monitoring them as we cared for them together. Additionally, she completed her lactation consultant training program and was helping us and new moms as we entered the early stages of developing our lactation center within our practice. She did all of these things while still taking every opportunity to greet and interact with a child, to meet them where they were. She did a lot, but never seemed busy, never seemed frazzled, always had everything under control and made things more fun and joyful and silly all along the way. And pregnancy didn't slow her down. We were so excited and eager to meet Lennon. Ashley and Chris put up with our pleading for them to have a baby for quite a while, and we were overjoyed at the news. I recently told Chris that I worried we would drive Ashley insane because she had like 11 additional mamas telling her what to do and fussing over her each day. We knew they were going to be the best parents and couldn't wait to shower love all over that baby. Ashley already loved Lennon so much, and we were so privileged to share in her early mama journey. Despite all the tasks to accomplish throughout her day, despite her growing pregnant belly, she never stopped having a personal impact. She brought people together. She fostered community. Our team was more united and more joyful because she was there. Our patients felt individually helped and cared for because of the time and skill and the compassion she showed. And because of the personal, graceful, fun-loving touch she had, we were changed just by being around her. Since our sudden and unspeakable loss of Ashley, our patient families continue pouring in words of love and thanks and personal accounts of their interactions with her. We are all changed individually and collectively because of the life she lived each day. Several weeks ago, our staff surprised me with a very special gift for Bosses Day. They each wrote out words on a chalkboard, adjectives describing me from their perspective. And I must have been on good behavior because they were nice words, luckily for me. So then they took pictures of each person holding their word and placed it very prettily on a frame that hangs on my office wall. Beautiful Ashley's picture is one of them. She held up the word motivating. I wish, I hope, she knew how motivational she was when she was with us and will always be to us. We miss her already, but we are so united in our desire to shine all these beautiful qualities, her grace, her joy, her compassion, just as she's shown them on us each day.
Counting the ways to where you are. looked at her for a moment, and she feels better than ever, and we're on fire, making our way back from when you only got 100 years to live.
I tried to beat you, but you're so hot that I melted. I fell right through the cracks, and now I'm trying to get back. Before the cool done run out, I'll be giving it my bestest, and nothing's gonna stop me but divine intervention. I reckon it's again my turn to win some or learn some. I won't hesitate no more, no more. It cannot wait, I'm yours. Well, open up your mind and see like me. Open up your plans and damn, you're free. Look into your heart and you'll find love, love, love. Listen to the music of the moment, maybe sing with me. A la peaceful melody. It's your God-forsaken right to be loved, 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 loved. To lead a better life, I need my love to be here, making each day of the year, changing my life with a wave of a hand. Nobody can deny that there's something beside me, I know I need never care. But to love her is to need her everywhere. Knowing that love is to share. Each one believing that love never dies. Watching her eyes and hoping. I'm always there to be there and everywhere, here, there, and everywhere.
How does one speak to unspeakable pain and loss? Not with platitudes or cliches, not with oversimplifications, but with the recognition of how acute the pain is for us today. While it's not the only pain that has been experienced this week, it is so acute because it is our pain. It is your pain. It belongs to us. And it somehow connects us. And what is pain? Pain is understanding that we've been cut off from our deepest connections, whether it be bone and sinew, or being cut off from the hearts of those that we love. And a week ago, there was a breaking. A breaking of such power and pain that it sent a shockwave through us all. Ashley died last Sabbath. In the early hours, before the sun came up, on the day of worship for our community. Time stopped. No, time broke. Reality broke. And it's okay to call death what it is, a breaking of God's plan for us, of God's hope for us. The breaking is loud and ugly and not what we would want or wish on anyone. But the sun came up, as it always does. But this time everything was different, disconnected, and separate. But in the midst of the breaking, there was a heartbeat. Lennon. Even his name has the rhythm of a heartbeat. Lennon. So through the breaking came a connection, tenuous, but a connection. Lennon played his beating heart for us only a short time. But the impact of that life is rippling across the planet today. We have to ask the question, how do we measure a life? Is it in years, in days, in minutes or seconds? Or is it something else? Is it in the connections that one creates, that one life brings? Because if it is in the connecting, then both Ashley and Lennon lived big lives, huge lives. If you look around you, you can see the outcome of a life well lived. Ashley was made to be a mom. And so many of you know this because she was a mom to you or to your children. She nurtured so many of us through her laughter, her wonderful nature, her sassiness, and with her deep care for her patients and kids at Garden Pediatrics and the Child Center. Ashley was the center of many circles of care. She cared for her family, for your children, and she cared for Chris and her friends. She was always willing to sit through another concert or another practice to support your music because she was your biggest fan. She was such an integral part of this community. It's why none of you are alone in your suffering today. The pain of this breaking is shared between all of us. And while the pain does not dissipate as it goes out, it does somehow reconnect us. And while we can't shoulder your pain, we can carry ours beside you. We would take it from you if we could. That is what the Christian community can do best. But as we cannot carry it for you, we'll carry ours with yours, and we'll do it together. Together, we'll not understand why this happened. And together, we can ask how we can make it through. Perhaps at least one answer is simply that. We'll do it together. We'll do it connected. Because if death is a breaking, then love is a connecting. Love reconnects us to that hope, which is God, and to that truth, which is heaven. And what is grace? But God reaching down and connecting to us. That which was broken in a garden long ago is reconnected to the source of all life and all love. Paul understood this in his deeply personal words about connection in Romans 8, 38, 39, where he says, "And I am convinced," it's not the right word, "beyond a shadow of a doubt I know that nothing can separate us, disconnect us from God's love. Neither death," and he starts with that, because he knows how strong it is, but he knows it's not that strong. "Neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, neither our fears for today or our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from the love of God. No power in the sky above or in the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to disconnect us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord." The pain of separation can only be soothed by the power of connection. In this way, we see the huge life that Lennon lived in just 4 days. From his bed in the NICU at Loma Linda Children's Hospital, he was part of sending out just as big a shockwave of love around the world. And a deep connection to those who had suffered loss through death on their own. Read the blogs. Even the anonymous hate of the internet has been squelched for a moment with the love that Lennon sent out. Because if you measure a life by the power of connection, Lennon lived more than most of us have. And through this connection, there's been a circle of grace, of graciousness, and of gratitude that has become a reality. Throughout this experience, Lennon, Chris, and the family have experienced the grace of healthcare providers who believe that they don't have a job but a calling to share love and connection with those in pain. I'm talking about people like Dr. Richard Peverini, the neonatologist, Tracy Wetherill, the day nurse, Kelly Colliott, the night nurse, Hannah Diego, another night nurse. And in the midst of the most acute pain and loss they were suffering, there were those who showed mercy, compassion, and deep competency in the ED as they worked on Ashley and ultimately Lennon as well. We see that love carried out through Sherry Nolfi, the ED director, Dr. Michael Kimini, the ET attending, Dr. Heather Figueroa, the ED OBGYN, Dr. Eugene Kim, the new guy in the ED that night, Dr. Andrew Flannery, the ED resident, Dr. Shuby, the ED pediatric doctor, Miriam Anilis, the ED case manager, the LUMC ED staff, Chris Wilson, Jeremy Sherwin, Victor Tung, Lauren Martinez, Randy French, Jennifer Orozco, John Zepeda, Lindy Hertelli, Kelly Davis, and Kenny Lard. They all cared beyond, and we thank them for that. And as the immediacy of the crisis was becoming a reality that night at home, we saw the fast action and incredible care given by those first responders at Loma Linda Fire Department, especially Nick Gray and Jake Feenstra. And we've included these names not simply because Chris and Elizabeth, Ashley's mom, have asked us to, but because this is the part of Circle of Care that makes up a community. With a critical immediacy, each of you have become connected to Ashley and to Lennon and to Chris and Elizabeth and to us. Through your actions, you have been bound together in love, as we are called to be bound together in the bonds of Christian love, connection, and community together. In many ways, you who are sitting here are part of the circle of care as well. Even those who are watching this online tonight have a role to play in healing and support and love from this breaking. But we should ask the question, how do we make it through? How long and deep and wide is the sea of loss and pain? Today, it is as deep and wide as the ocean to the west of us, as vast as the land to the east of us and to another ocean. Too deep to swim, too far to run, if you're gonna do it alone. But it's not too far if we do it together. How do we make it through? I think there's only one way. It is to stay connected to that which is on the other side of pain, the other side of loss, the other side of silence, and the other side of death. There is only one thing that conquers the silence and separation of death. Only one thing that plumbs the depth of despair, yet comes out on the other side, not only unscathed, but victorious. It is the hope of heaven, as seen through the incarnation of Jesus. It is the comfort of the Holy Spirit, seen in the hand of a friend or a family member. It is the kindness that can be experienced through brotherly communion in the presence of God. It is the coming together of the community to weep, to heal, to laugh, and to eventually be stronger. Stronger in connection, stronger in faith, stronger in the conviction of heaven, and stronger in the hope for the second coming of Jesus Christ. John the Revelator speaks to this coming of Jesus and the hope that he has for heaven in Revelation 21. He says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the old heaven and the old earth had disappeared." And then he sticks on this strange phrase where he says, "And the sea was also gone." Everything is new. The old has disappeared along with the suffering and pain. But John says this phrase. It almost seems peculiar. He says, "The sea is no more." Why would he mention that? Could it be that he was writing from a place of deep disconnect with everyone that he loved? He had been exiled to Patmos. He was dead to them, and them to him, only memory. But as he sees the new heaven and the new earth, he sees something different than the view that he saw every single day when he woke up, because all he saw was the sea that separated. And in the new heaven and new earth, the sea was gone, because he knew he would never be disconnected again, not from his God, not from his family, not from his community, and not from the love that we share together. He would never be separated. He's saying the same thing as Paul. So he sees heaven, and for him, it's connection. Nothing was broken off. Nothing will be broken off. He sees God's world as God had planned for it in the first place, a place with no sorrow, with no mourning, because we are always connected to one another, to the God of this earth, and to everyone who has left before us. The kingdom of heaven is expressed in the connections that conquer death. And as we hold one another tonight, deep in our grief and our sorrow, that is appropriate because of who Ashley was and who Lennon was. We know that even in this sorrow, the death has not won. Death has not won. Death will never win. Death will never be victorious over the connection of a community that remembers, that honors, that lifts up, and that connects to heaven through Jesus Christ. In this way, we can truthfully say, with hope, that this is our Father's world.
We've come here tonight to do the impossible. And that is to sum up someone's life in a collection of words or pictures. And we know that. We know that's not possible to do. I've had an outpouring of love and support. Most of them involve the words, "I know words aren't enough, but..." And now I know how that feels, because when I say thank you to all of you, that's not enough. I could never articulate how much your support and your strength and your prayers and your emails and your Facebook messages and your text messages, I don't know how any of you got my number, but there's... it's been a lot of me just, okay, thank you. I didn't bother going into the whole, "I don't know who you are, but thank you." It has meant so much to me, and so... when I say thank you, I know exactly what you mean. There's so much more inside of me that I want to express, but we're left with these words. So I hope that will suffice for now. I didn't want to write anything down because I knew that would be even harder to do, so forgive my non-linear thinking. There's a couple of things I want, and that's a very short list of things that I want. I want us to ask the questions. I want us to feel comfortable asking the questions. There's no wrong question. I have a lot of questions. People have been coming to me for answers, and I don't. But I want when all the questions have passed, I want the theme and I want the focus, and I want each and every one of you to join me in asking the question, "What now?" To me, that's the most important question, and I think that's the question that Ashley would ask. What now? As we remember, as we look back, what does that mean for my life now? What does that change about who I am now? What does that mean for how I reach out to other people who I see suffering? What now? And I think that's the question we need to ask. So when you're ready to ask that question, let's dream together. Let's see what we can do. Let's see how we can live better lives. Let's see how we can love more. There have been so many people that have reached out and shared their pain, deep, excruciating pain, tremendous loss, and my heart just goes out. So what now? What do I do? What do we do? One of the themes of our relationship for me and Ashley, as it's been said, that we met as a result of a tragic, tragic event, unspeakable tragedy. That's how we met. And so something good came from something so tragic. So from this unspeakable tragedy, that's what I want. I want good to come out of this. So many voices out there that have reached out to me didn't have the support, didn't have the random viral video, didn't have this opportunity, didn't have this momentum. And so for whatever reason, we have this. And so what now? What good can we bring out of this? To this broken world, what good can we bring out of this? I know that God did not compose this. This was not. God had nothing to do with this. But I can see him tears streaming down his face, beginning to compose one note at a time, the most beautiful melody that anyone has ever heard. And I don't know what that sounds like, but that's the God that I believe in. This is my father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the my father's world. The birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declare their maker's praise. This is my this is my father's world.
right though the wrong seems off so strong. God is the ruler, yeah. This is my Father's world. The battle is not done. Jesus, who died, shall be satisfied. And earth and heaven be one. This is my Father's world. The battle is not done. And Jesus, who died, shall be satisfied. And earth and heaven be one.
Will you please remain standing? I have the impossible task of ending this with prayer. Will you grab the people next to you, please? God, we stand as a community and we have no answers. But Lord, we want to know the God that Chris knows. Lord, we are so grateful for incredible Ashley and how today she's made us all better people. Lord, she left too soon, but we have hope and we are so grateful for it. Lord, allow us to leave this place tonight to make smart choices, to go into the world and to make a world a better place, because some good must come from this. Be with us, God, and allow us to provide the support that's necessary for this grieving community. Be in this place, we ask. In the precious name of Jesus Christ, amen. Whew. I ask that you remain seated until the family has exited. Those family that feel able will be on the north lawn immediately to my left, and you can go out there and greet them and support them out there. There are some cookies and things out there. Immediately behind us is the guest book. If you haven't been able to sign that, please do so. And again, on behalf of Chris, Ashley, all of the families, thank you for being here tonight.